Hey, folks, this is Ben, the hot dog answer man, and I'm glad you're with me today. I wanted to talk about collecting sales tax. I get asked that a lot, about how to do it, the different methods for doing it, and explaining what it is, basically, and what's the difference between a tax ID and a resale ID, and those types of terms used by your state and federal government. So let's start off and clear the air about a tax ID, because the name is interchanged with a federal ID, which is a tax ID. It's called an EIN, or a employer identification number, but it's also referred to as a tax ID. But also, in your state, there's a sales tax, or most of you will have. We'll discuss that in a minute. And when you do it, when you have a sales tax, a lot of people refer to that as a tax ID. But really what it is a resale ID. It's basically a license to buy and not pay taxes and to be able to resell it and collect taxes then, hence giving the state more income, okay? They didn't take it up front. They took it later when you sold it for a profit. And so wholesalers don't collect tax. Places like Sam's, BJ's, Costco, if you use those to buy your products or your supplies, then you can get a tax ID from your state and purchase stuff from them without paying tax. So that's the gist of it. But the difference between an employer ID, I cover this in the blog at learnhotdogs.com. But to give you just a brief example, an employer ID or a federal ID is your taxes due for your income, not your sales, but your income, like they would be at a job. Your payroll is your income. Well, when you are your own employer, like you are when you own your own concession trailer or hot dog cart, you are your own employer and you'll want a federal ID. That federal ID is linked to your social. It's basically the social security number for your business, and then you have a social security number for your person. And that's what that is. So don't get the two confused. What we're talking about today is State Department of Revenue, and specifically your state. And so what we want to be able to do is find out how to get this information from the state so that we know if we even need to collect taxes and how to do it and all those things. But here's the things we want to do and ask. First, let's Google them. So what we would do is log on online. We'd go to Google or Bing or one of the search engines, and we'd type in Department of Revenue, and maybe you could put the acronym for your state, the abbreviation. So if you're in Tennessee, it'd be TN. And so you'd put Department of Revenue TN. And that will pull up a bunch of stuff, a bunch of search queries. But the problem is, or search results, those in those results are these other websites that will pull up automatically, like file your State Department of Revenue taxes here. And these are sites that are either sponsored by the state, or they figured out a way to make money off you in the process, or they'll file and get your number for you, is something you can do yourself. But here's how to determine them. The ones that end in .org are the important ones. .gov. .gov. So if it ends in a .gov, like instead of .com or .org or .whatever, make sure it's .gov and click on it. Go to that site, because that's your government site, and that's going to give you the biggest amount of help. So keep that in mind when you're doing the search. Then, obviously, you can get on the phone and call them once you've found their number and found the department you want. If you can't find the department or the number, call the local, as far as call the main number, and you'll get an operator, and they can give you the right department. And ask them for the number so you can write it down, because you'll want it for your records and so that you can call them if you ever have questions down the road. Let's see here. So you've Googled them and you've called them, and now what you're going to need to know is what are you going to ask them? So we're going to ask, do you in your state, are you responsible for collecting taxes, sales tax, on food? Some states will say no. Most states will say yes. Some states will say yes, but only on prepared foods. Well, in your case, everything you're doing is prepared. You're preparing food and handing it to them ready to eat. Now, if you're selling little grab bags that they go home and cook their own hot dogs and add their bun, and you give them ketchup packets and stuff, and so there's nothing they can eat right there at your cart, then that would be a little different. That'd be a packaged food that's to be prepared later, and your state may not require you collect taxes, but I don't know any vendors doing that. We're all selling something they can eat right now. So, once you find out you have to, if you don't have to, you don't even have to watch the rest of this video. But if you do collect it on prepared foods or foods, period, then you'll want to watch this and learn some tips and tricks on figuring taxes, how to collect taxes, when and why, and all that stuff. We're also going to want to know tax rate. States will have a rate, a base rate. They'll say our state sales tax is 5%. But your county may have, they may ask you, what county are you in? Well, I'm in Jefferson County. Well, Jefferson County collects 2%. So that's a total rate of 7%. And it's not like you have to send 2% to the county and or to 1% to the city and 2% to the county and 5% to the state. It all typically goes to the state, and the state divvies it out to the different counties and cities or municipalities in your state. So it's still a tax. And it's a state sales tax. So once you find out that rate, write it down. They'll probably tell you something like in Tennessee, it's 7%. And then it's 2.75% for my city county tax. So my total is 9.75%. And that's all I really need to know. I kind of just went over the city county state issue. So I'm going to jump on down. I killed two birds with one stone with that tax rate. Now, also, the application process. Some of them do it online, and it's very easy. Some of them you have to print off, you know, or request a form, or you can go down to a local county office, and they'll give you a form. There's several ways to get it. It's usually simple and easy. It doesn't require a lot of thought to fill out your tax thing. They usually are more than happy to sign you up because it means you're going to be sending them money. So, and you're collecting it for them as well. Something I'll just mention just for FYI, for fun, some states actually pay you to collect it. Some of them say, we'll give you 0.1% of everything you collect. Well, that's fantastic because it pays you a little bit for your time and having to even deal with the paperwork monthly. The other thing is most states want you to report monthly. Not all of them, but most of them want you to report monthly. And so they may say, you collect in January, you owe us in February by this date. You collect in December, you owe us in January, however it is. Some of them may say, well, you can pay it quarterly. So you'll work January, February, March, and all of that tax collected in those 3 months is due in April. That's typically how it's done. But for the most part, we all pay taxes monthly because they want it as soon as you can get it to them, and you can't give it to them for a month until the month's over. So they obviously give you a few days to figure that out. Most of them give you till the 15th of the following month. So that's all there is to it. You can ask them those questions, and it shouldn't be even a long phone call. You should be able to get it all figured out pretty quick. Most of them have some pretty adept sites on their website as far as the adept information, and they'll tell you, they'll answer all these questions online. But if you're like a lot of us, we want our answers right now. We'll get on the phone, and we'll ask the questions, and that way we're good to go, and we can start preparing how we're going to do it. I know that this stuff is, you know, overwhelmed. So let's go on to the easy stuff. We need to have a formula for figuring our taxes, a math formula. It's real easy. You just take some numbers, plug them into some other numbers, divide and subtract and, you know, the square root of a tree and do those things. And I'm just messing with you, but that was funny. And so the math formula I'm going to show you is much easier than any of this, and you'll find that it's not hard, especially if you do a couple practice ones, and I'm going to do a couple with you today, and you'll have it down pat, and it won't even be an issue. So what we're going to do is I want to bring up something here because some people teach or advise you on how to collect tax, and they make it sound simple, and they will say something like this. They'll say, hey, just take your total sales for the month and multiply it times your tax rate. That's your tax due. So I'm going to assume for right now, because I'm going to cover both of these, so don't worry. I'm going to assume you're going to have your taxes built into the price of your food. So if you have a $5 Happy Meal, it's going to be $5 to the customer. It's not plus tax. So we're going to talk about the add and tax after in a minute. but stick with me if you're going to do it this way. Some vendors just add the tax on top as they sell. I'll show you the pros and cons of that method in a second, and you can make a more educated decision on how you want to do it. I've got friends that, you know, do it both ways. Okay, so we are going to assume that our tax rate is 7.35. It doesn't really matter what you plug in there, but I'm just giving you an example. And let's also take for an example the easy way some people teach. There's a popular blogger and course seller online that tells you to just take your total amount sold each month, multiply it times your tax rate, and so you take 7368, multiply it times your tax rate of 7.35, and you'll get $541.55 in taxes. And that doesn't sound that bad. It just, that means you've had it built into your amount of your food, and that's how you get it. And that is simple. Okay. The problem is you're paying for that simplicity, and I'm going to tell you why. Here's why. You don't really owe $541.55, and I don't know anybody on the planet that wants to pay in more than they collected. I don't want to. I don't want to pay them for more, because all you're doing is giving them what you collect. Why would you pay them extra? You didn't collect $7,368 plus $541. You only collected $7,368 for the month. So why on earth would you want to pay extra? Am I right or am I right? So basically we have the dumb way, which cost us $541.55 in taxes. And then we have a smarter way. So we're going to look at that. So we took in total sales $7,368 for the month. Now we need to back out the taxes from that figure. So we're going to have to subtract out, not add in, but subtract out the taxes that we collected. And how you would do that is you would get your calculator, enter in 7368, then hit the divide sign key, you know, divide by key, and enter the tax rate like this. In our previous example, the tax rate was 7.35, so we're going to stick with that. So you divide by 1.0735 and hit the equal sign. That's the only math you have to know, is a divide key and how to convert the percentage down to this type of a decimal. So you'd hit 7368, divide by 1.0735, you'll equal 686353, which is really the number that represents what you made in sales plus tax. Now we add the tax. So how we do that is we just figure out what's the difference. We know we sold 7368, right? We know that our tax rate is 7.35. We just subtracted that out, so we get 686353. So all you do is minus that out. So take your 7368, your total in sales, minus the number you just came up with, which is 686353, and that will equal 50447. And I don't know if you're as sharp as a tack today, but that's a big difference between 54155. You may be saying, "Now, Ben, come on now, that's crazy. You're arguing over $37. Well, I can tell you this. I don't know any of us that walking down the street saw a $20 bill on the ground, much less two of them, and wouldn't pick it up. I'm going to, and I would hope you would too. That's $37. That's the cost of going out to eat, you know, with your family, or maybe saving it up. I mean, because 37 turns into, in this example, $444 a year. A year. Why would you give the government $444 extra dollars? If you want to donate to them, that by all means do. But if I'm going to donate to them, I want to know I'm doing it. I don't want to do it on accident. And if you've been doing your taxes this other way, which I know is taught, you're doing it wrong. And even the state will tell you you're doing it wrong. But they're not going to tell you if you're already doing it. They're not going to call you and go, "Hey, John, this is Leroy down here at the state, and we noticed that you've been overpaying your taxes, and we'd like to know if you want that check or cash to get that back. They're not going to do it. They're not going to call you back and say, you know, here's your money back. They don't care. They're going to take it off your figures. And if you did your figures at $73.68 plus the taxes, you're going to be paying them $541.55, and they're not going to know that you did overpay them, really. They're not going to know how you came up with your number. They're just going to go, okay, sounds good. Everything looks good. Thanks for the tip. And you'll be done. I wouldn't do that. If you make more in a month, obviously you're going to be paying them more unnecessarily to the government. And who would do that other than a crazy person? I know some of you may be doing that method now because that's what you were taught and a course you bought, but please stop now. It doesn't mean you're dumb. It just means you were taught wrong. And so that's why I do these, is I want you to do it the right way. Let's do one more for practice, just for fun. And if this could be considered fun, let's do one more for practice, and we'll use some different numbers so you can try this. If you have a calculator, pull it out and go with me on this. But what we're going to do is we're going to pretend that your tax rate is 5.67%. Your sales for the month are $86.98, okay? We know what we have to do. We have to take out the taxes from that, back them out. And the way to do that is to take the $86.98 divided by 1.0567. The 5.67 is representative of your 5.67%. That will give you equals 8231.29, which means that's how much you really made in sales plus tax. It'd be the same as saying my hot dog's $1.80 plus tax. So 86.98 minus the 8231 leaves us with 466.71 owed in tax, and that is accurate. So that's all you owe. Now, most states will tell you to round up or round down to the nearest dollar. So if it was your change there is 466.71, in this case, you'd send them 467. But it still beats sending them $500 because you added 5.67% to the $8,700 in collected funds. And I've hoped that none of y'all would do that now after watching this. So let's check our math. Let me show you how to check your math. And it's real easy. You remember this in school probably, where you do a problem and then you do it backwards to see if your math worked. And so that's all we're going to do here. So according to our numbers, we had sales of $8,231.29. That's what the figure was after we backed out the tax. So now we need to add tax. So take your tax rate of 5.67% and add it to your sales amount. There's two ways to do this depending on your calculator, and depending on the button options. But most calculators have this button. Now, let me tell you just a quick tip here. You can Google and put in sales tax calculator, and it'll pull up one that's free you can use online, or you can put in financial calculator. It'll pull one up online. You don't have to have a fancy calculator to do any of this. You can do it right online. Most of you can do it from your smartphone. So 8231.29 plus the 5.67% should equal the 86.98 we had in sales. And if you look at the top right up there, we did. We had 86.98 in sales, so everything worked. Ta-da, we did it. We're done. We're winners. Practice that a few times, and it will become easy as pumpkin pie. Now, let's talk about those pros and cons I told you a little earlier. Now, this is all about not collecting tax, having it built in. This is about adding on. So when a customer comes up and says, hey, the value meal is $5, and they pull out a $5 out of their wallet, you go, whoa, wait just a second, I got to add tax. Oh, it's $5.35. Okay? So we're going to talk about the pros and cons of this. Let's go through the pros. At the end of the day or the month, you only have to add up the sales tax collected. For an example, if you've watched my tutorials on keeping good records, even if you're using a legal pad like I do, you would have your days worked, and out beside it, you'd have the sales. In this case, you'd have the sales amount you did, and then out beside it, you'd have the tax you collected, because you collected it separately. You added it to the customer when they were buying. So you'll have good numbers. It'll be easy to add up. You won't have to know that fancy divide key or none of that stuff that I just showed you. So it will be easier. You lose nothing from the sale. amount charged because tax is added afterwards. A lot of people are under the misconception, and this is just a mental thing. It messes with your head. A lot of people go, well, dadgum, I did $8,000 in sales, but then I had to back out the taxes, so really I only did $7,600 in sales. Crap, I ain't doing it that way anymore. I'm just going to add taxes later. Now, I have two good friends who add taxes during the sale because mentally they don't like, I guess they don't like to think about that they're giving up taxes. But the gist is, let's say you know what you want for a total amount on a hot dog. Say you want $2, period, before taxes. Well, you could build in the taxes to it and make it 2 1/4 or 2.15 or 2.50 or whatever it is. You could add that in there and then give the customer a flat rate, but some people do not want to do it that way. They just want to add the tax after the sale or during the sale. And so it has a, I guess the preconceived notion would be is that you lost nothing by doing it, the adding it at the sale. So that's kind of a pro. You don't have to know crazy math formulas like I showed you earlier. You don't have to know any of that stuff to do it this way. And I'm not beating anybody up. So if you do it this way, don't think that I'm beating you up. I just feel and believe that it's quicker, easier, faster to do it the other way. So now let's get to the cons, okay? And this is where I beat you up a little bit if you're doing it this way. Some customers will not like it. I mean, can you imagine going to the fair? You go up to the concession thing. You say, give me one of them elephant ears and two funnel cakes. And you know it's $2 for each of them. And you pull out your $6. You got it ready. And they go, well, hold on. It's going to be $6.72 with tax. And you go, what? Because nobody does that. I mean, very few vendors charge tax at the sale, especially in those environments. They want to make it simple as pie. Now, if you're in a slower area and you're not fast-paced place vending, it's okay. It ain't going to require anything else, but we're going to get to that. Requires you to have a tax chart or a calculator program for everything you sell. So there are some cool little handy tax charts. I've got a buddy that does it this way, and he's got a little tax chart pinned up onto his cart, and it's laminated even, and he just goes down it with his finger, and it tells him the tax amount for the amount they bought. And so it makes it easy. Sometimes it won't fall into your tax chart, and you may want to have a calculator handy so you can figure their taxes. Now, takes more time. I've already kind of touched on this, but it does take more time. If you got a line of people and somebody comes up and orders some oddball configurations of your menu and you don't have it in your head already what that's going to be, it can require more time. It also requires more time because it takes change. Because a lot of times you'll end up with $5.19. And so some customers will give you $6. Well, that's not hard math. You go, okay, I got to count out, you know, 81 cent. And so you count out your 81 cent and hand it to them. Well, that means I'm having to keep change now. I've got to have quarters, nickels, dimes, and pennies. Good heavens, I don't want any of that crap. I don't want it. I just like having my ones, fives, and tens. All my prices are dollars. There's no 50 cents and quarters and pennies and dimes. I don't do it. But so it will require you to have more coins, okay, or coins, period. And it's also going to require you to be able to think quickly on your feet, okay, because it's easy to make a mistake when you're doing these things. So if you're not real quick on your feet, you'll get the hang of it. Like I said, I've got two friends that do it this method, and they swear by it. So don't do it how you want to try it both ways or take all this information to make an educated decision on how you want to do it. But it's easier to make a mistake on the go. Let's say somebody gets in line and you're busy. Okay. You're busy, 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 busy. And the meal comes up to $4.27. Okay. And they hand you a 5 2/4. And you go, what? What? Okay. Now I got to take 27 out of the 50. Okay. That's 13. Isn't that right? 13, 3, and 30. No, that's 18. And then so all of that is slowing you down. It's all slowing you down. So you don't want to do that. You want to have a method that is quick and painless for them and for you. And so I would say do it the the easier way to me. But that's the pros and cons of that. Let's go to charging sales tax on what? You know, how do you figure out what you're supposed to charge sales tax on? My napkins, my foil? Most states require you collect tax on anything purchased that will be resold. So what about your napkins or hot dog trays? Napkins are resold. I mean, they are, aren't they? You're not like selling napkins individually. You don't have a sign up that says napkin special, 5 cents a piece, but you are going to give them a napkin with their meal, which they just bought. So it's being sold. But the new umbrella you just bought isn't going to be resold. The hot dog trays are resold, but the cleaning supplies you bought are not. And so this can get a little confusion. You'll be like, oh, my me. You know, I go to Sam's Club and I buy this and that. I buy cleaning supplies. I buy paper towels, hot dog trays, hot dogs, buns, ketchup, mustard, a new ketchup pump. What do I do? How do I determine what to pay taxes on? Well, you've got all this stuff and it's, you know, in your head. And I've had people call me from BJ's or Sam's and go, Ben, I'm glad you picked up because I'm in a bind here. I had to get hot dogs and I got 4 cases of hot dogs and I got ketchup, but I had to get a new pump. And so I didn't know, do I use my tax ID on the other stuff and not on the pump, or can I use it all on the pump? Because they're not going to stop you at Sam's. They don't care what you buy on your tax ID because you're responsible to the state, not to them. So I've had some customers call me. And so, you know, in the store or in the line trying to figure out what to do, and I'm going to make this easy for you, and I'll do some magic here and sort this out for you. But basically, you could, if you wanted to be almost anal retentive and separate it all out and go, okay, here's my taxed items, here's my resale items. My resale items, I'll use my tax ID or my resale ID, and I won't have to pay taxes. But over here, this stuff, I'm not reselling. It's part of just running an operation, so I'm going to pay taxes on that stuff. That's how typically your state is going to want you to do it, but that is a nightmare. Let me tell you, it will make you turn your head upside down and lose your mouth and grow hair on your chin like that. So I'm going to show you what most vendors do to cut through the chase. Most vendors go to their supplier and purchase everything under their tax-exempt number or resale ID because all of it is used in the process of reselling and therefore factored in, okay? So you know, like 409 or whatever kind of cleaner you keep on your cart. Even though you're not giving any of that to the customer, it's part of the process of selling, and it's being resold because it's a consumable. You're having to use it so that you can sell. And so you could buy that on, you know, with your tax exempt number and not pay taxes and probably be okay. You may want to check with your state and double check with them, but I'm telling you what most of us do, no matter what they say, because otherwise it becomes a nightmare. But I'm telling you what most vendors do. Now, if you went to Sam's Club or BJ's or wherever and, you know, you said, oh, man, the truck needs new tires, I'm going to go ahead and get tires, and the wife's been looking at that fancy LCD TV, I'm going to pick that up, and you loaded it all onto that big, long cart and pushed it up there with your 10 cases of hot dogs, and you go, here's my tax ID number, and so they don't charge you tax on none of it. They're not going to care what you bought on it. You leave, and, you know, 3 months later, you filed your tax returns. But here's the problem. Let's say you show, or Sam's reports to the IRS, or not the IRS, but the local state Department of Revenue, that on this tax number, $4,000 was purchased for the month of March. Okay? Now, they don't audit each one of these every month, but I'm just giving you an example. So Sam's reports that to the state, $4,000. The state looks at your sales report for March and they go, huh, in April he filed his March taxes and it shows he did $3,200. So where's all this other stuff? And why isn't there a profit on what he bought? So they're thinking you should have like $5,000 because you bought $3,000. Well, if they called you, or you know, they'll send you a letter and say, you know, explain this. I have not heard of any vendor having this issue, but I'm telling you what you're supposed to do. What you should have done is separate that out. Buy the 10 hot dog boxes with no tax, buy the TV and the tires and pay tax. That's how it should be done. Otherwise, it could cause you a little bit of problems because you wouldn't be able to show how you resold that TV and paid them taxes on it. So keep that in mind. You don't want to go overboard with that. The bottom line is use common sense. I mean, I'm going to buy my 409 or my stainless steel cleaner at Sam's, and I'm not going to pay taxes on it because it's part of the consumables of serving. But the TV isn't. And so let's talk about cheating a little bit, because there's some vendors that do this, and I'm not going to be the one to judge and say it's right or wrong. It's not. I don't know the legalities of it, but I know that there's some vendors that cheat the system a little bit. For example, I know some vendors that will, they'll go to Sam's Club or Costco and purchase their stock without using their tax number or ID. Okay, so they don't even use it. So nobody knows. There's no record of it. There's nothing. So nothing goes to the Department of Revenue saying Ben just bought this stuff and paid tax. It doesn't say it. So there's no record. This means they pay tax right then and there, though. So if you could go in and buy 100 cases of hot dogs and 42 cases of water, and you'd go, okay, here's my stuff, and I'm going to go ahead and pay taxes on it. Well, then they'll go out and sell those goods, okay, at their normal prices, and they don't report any sales tax. So they sold all the stuff, but they already paid tax at Sam's. So some of them think, well, I don't owe any tax now because I already paid it. But that's not really the case. This may work if you used it occasionally, but the state is going to expect a return every month. And so when you return, hey, I'm in business, I didn't buy anything this month on my tax number, and so they'll go, well, did you sell anything? Well, you'd have to put zeros in that box, because otherwise they're going to want their money. They're not going to accept, yeah, but I paid taxes at Sam's. They want taxes on your sale price, not on your Sam's price. So you're going, well, I didn't have any sales then. I mean, that's basically what you'd have to do. Now, I know some of them that just sporadically do this. They don't do that every month, or they basically in a month's time, they may do two purchases at Sam's for $500 each that they pay their taxes on right then and there. And then they use that inventory in amongst the other inventory. And that way they can gain a little more profit. If you follow what I'm saying, it's not the right way, and it can get you in a sling, because here's the bottom line. The state expects that return, and they, it could cause some red flags, but the state considers your business a privilege. Not that they're a privilege to you, that you're a privilege. You're basically, it's a privilege to be in business. So some of these states call this a privilege license, even the sales tax. So if your business license, it could be called a privilege license. Well, it is, you know, it's a privilege, you know, because you get to go out and bust your butt and work and collect money for them, and them not reward you for it in any way, shape, or fashion, other than the fact that hey, we let you work. Isn't that cool? And I know that I could go into a whole tangent on that, but the bottom line is they consider it a privilege and therefore expect you to pay tax for that privilege. So even though you're not paying the tax, it's passed to the customer. They've already received taxes on those goods if you went to Sam's and you paid taxes. But if you resell it, they want the resale taxed and paid to them as well. Well, you don't want to pay both. So honestly and truthfully, it's better all the way around, the legal way, the right way, the book way, is to purchase without paying taxes. So use your tax ID and collect taxes during the sale and then pay those to the state monthly. That's how the state wants you to do it. And that's really it. That's all, folks. I hope that helps clear the mud about taxes. Please note, though, that I am not, and I emphasize not, a licensed tax professional, okay? This information is not to be used as tax advice or interpreted as tax advice in any way, shape, form, or fashion. The information covered here was for the purpose in showing you examples on how to collect tax and pay your sales taxes only. So always check with your state office or your tax local tax office, or call the Department of Revenue for your state and get the information from them on how. I've already told you what to ask. Now you know how to apply that information, whatever it comes as, and you'll be able to do it. Please remember to join me over at learnhotdogs.com, because I do a blog and you can learn a lot. We add stuff all the time and we have all kinds of little deals and stuff going on. So I would love it if you'd support the blog. I'd love it even more if you'd subscribe to the newsletter. It doesn't cost you anything. Just subscribe over there on the blog and you'll get, you know, every time I put out a post or a video or something, you'll get a little email telling you. And that's how simple that is. I would love it if you do that. Also, if you have any questions or would like to see a video on a specific thing, please send a request. You can go over to learnhotdogs.com/feedback and get gobs of information. You can submit a, you know, for that information, you can submit, hey, Ben, I'd really like to know about air and up tires or whatever it is. And I'll try to get to it. So please do that. That'll help out, or I'll answer your questions live on the radio. We do a radio show weekly on Sundays at 8:30 p.m. Eastern time. If you miss it, it's available free on iTunes and downloadable. It's also posted on the blog with show notes. Keep in mind as well that, and I would love your support here, if you go over to learnhotdogs.com, at the top of the screen, you'll see a thing that says products. Okay. I sell Mary Kay products. I'm just kidding. I have courses that will blow your mind. Like the A to Z course has this tax information in it. It has a lot of other stuff in it too. It's 11 videos long and you can get it instant. It's instant. You get to watch it right now. And so I have those things and I appreciate that support, and that's how I pay for the server and it's how I pay for the stuff. So I thank you for supporting me. I thank you for listening. I hope this helped. If you have any questions or think that I missed something or didn't cover something thoroughly, or you'd like to see me do a different example, please let me know. I'd be happy to help you. And y'all have a wonderful day. This is learnhotdogs.com. I am the Hot Dog Answer Man. Thanks for watching.